YouTuber sigh. I guess I'd better get around to this then, eh? I need to say up front that I will not be discussing the gameplay at all this time. Not much has really changed since Injustice 1 and MKX, and I'm tired of stupid people who can't string together a decent comment saying that I just hate the games because I'm bad at them, despite the vast majority of my discussion being of the plots because Netherrealm fanboys are fucking scum. The rest of the fans are alright though. If you want gameplay discussion, go watch the previous critiques. I know this one's shorter than the others and will probably feel pretty bare bones from the exclusion of certain sections you'd expect to be present, but just imagine it's a metaphor for my patience with Netherrealm's bullshit or for the game's depth. It's funny, really. I released the MKX critique last year before I played Injustice 2 through the Gold Edition. At the time, I said that the vast amount of content was something I could always praise Netherrealm for. Little did I fucking know what awaited me, or rather didn't, in Injustice 2. It's just challenge towers. Outside of story mode and online, all there is to do is the multiverse mode, which is a series of randomized challenge towers you play for golden loot, which is also how arcade mode works now. Do a tower as a character and you get their ending. The endings are done in the same style as MKX's, but with the characters themselves narrating the events rather than some nameless narrator. This helps to add some characterization to the cast, which is needed when the characters don't get to do much in the story. But there's no Star Labs type mode, no unlockable concept art, no vaults, nothing. Once you finish the story and get all the arcade endings, all that's left is the online and the less specifically crafted, often bullshit towers. It's such a shallow offering that really sticks out from the rest of Netherrealm's catalogue. The biggest new addition this time around is the gear system. Rather than alternate costumes, the game allows you to customize your character's outfit like in Soul Calibur. The difference is that those games have, like, cool items, while Injustice just gives you 5,000 variations on boring armor for characters that have no business being in armor. And worse, most pieces are actually two pieces. For instance, a Superman headpiece is part headgear and part cape. As a result, you often have multiple pieces with the same cape but slightly different headgear instead of just letting both be separate parts to allow greater freedom of expression and to cut down on the number of twices you get. A better system would have been to make classic costumes in pieces, then let the player mix and match like in Soul Calibur. Imagine Flash with his TV mask, movie top and Jay Garrick's pants. Or Batman with his Justice League mask and goggles, Arkhamverse upper body, New 52 lower body and Batman Beyond glider in place of his cape. Certainly sounds a lot cooler than armor or more armor or even more armor with a face covering visor. I think they did this with the Justice League movie costumes, which are obtained in specific rotating multiverse towers rather than just letting the player have them. Most of what you get is too similar. There's a limit on how much of it you can hold. You have to level up your character to meet the gear's level requirement in a fighting game, and it comes in randomized loot boxes. Honestly, while MK11's take is nothing special, it's certainly an improvement on this half-baked failure. The far better new addition is Premier Skins. Superhero settings often have the problem that the most popular slash iconic characters are the dark reflections of the heroes or successors with the same abilities. And while it's easy enough to make Venom play differently from Spider-Man, the same can't be said of Reverse Flash, Jon Stewart or Power Girl. So Netherrealm's solution was to make special skins for existing characters that turn them into other, similar characters, going so far as to change their voices, interactions with other characters and the HUD and announcements. Names. This way, the team don't need to make redundant characters, but don't have to exclude certain iconic characters either. Technically, the system has existed since before this, with Nightwing, Jon Stewart, Arrowverse Green Arrow, and Cyborg Superman in the first game, but this game made it a real system and even allows those characters to show up in the story mode. This does make me question why, of the initial four of these, only two show up in the story. I get that one is dead and one is from another universe, but they could have started with other characters that could appear or found another way to include them like Fear Toxin. I do have to take issue with the roster though, because like the first game, it's just overly filled with Batman characters, or at least characters who are often associated with Batman nowadays like Deadshot. I get that Batman's popular and that he has this expansive rogues gallery that is considered one of the best, if not the best in all of comics, but I'd really like to see characters from other properties getting more play. Like, it's cool to see a bunch of Flash characters getting appearances this time. As for the game's voice cast, as with everything else, it's much more consistent than Mortal Kombat, with only two actors not returning. Hal Jordan is now voiced by Steve Bloom, coming over from voicing three characters in MKX, while Neil McDonough didn't return as either Barry or Damian, leading to two fitting recasts. Damian is now voiced by Scott Porter, who was Dick Grayson in Arkham Knight. Barry, meanwhile, is voiced by Taliesin Jaffe, reprising the role from MK vs. DC Universe. That's fucking awesome! They went to a previous actor who was proven to be good in the role and got him to reprise the role. Sure would have been nice if they'd done the same thing with MK11. Many of the newcomers also have role reprisals, or at least actors who have been in DC productions in the past. The outlier, and one of the most perfect casting decisions of all time, is Robert fucking Englund as the Scarecrow. That's amazing!
I know, right?
Ironically, they couldn't get him in as Freddy Krueger, but that's besides the point. He would make a perfect Scarecrow. In fact, if you're looking to put Scarecrow in another movie, Warner Bros., that's your Scarecrow right there! Like, did the person in charge of casting for this game get fired between it and MK11? What the hell happened? I do have to question though why Power Girl, an alternate universe version of Supergirl, has a completely different voice actress than the normal Supergirl, because then you could reuse certain voice lines and make it a bit cheaper, and maybe you would have had a bit more money to then make more premier skins. As for the intros, the match will start with one character having a more traditional intro, before then borrowing MKX's system of three line exchanges unique to each pair of characters. I do still like this system, but the extra animation at the start does slow it down a little, not as much as MK11's does, but it's a fairly minor gripe that's not really that important. The sheer cost of the voice acting for these is presumably the reason why we didn't get as many premier skins as one might have expected, as they'd need unique voice actors and lines. There are three flaws with the system this time, however. 1. Presumably to help cut down costs, quite a few lines are reused between different exchanges, particularly when interacting with the DLC characters.
Call me the Ghost of Arrow Past.
That's a first.
I am Sub-Zero, Grandmaster of the Lin Kuei.
That's a first.
This is gonna be good.
I need to know what you can do.
You may retreat with no dishonor.
I need to know what you can do. Why should I trust you? Why should I trust you? Why should I trust you?
I can accept this as a cost-cutting measure as long as the exchanges still make sense, but they sometimes don't.
It's not too late to walk away.
Your concern is appreciated.
It's where you go from here that matters.
Second, despite being used as a method of deepening characterization or outright being the only source of characterization, they often contradict each other.
Batman was right disowning you.
I've got no regrets.
Not even over Dick's murder?
You're burning the wrong bridges.
I want none with Dick Grayson's killer.
It was an accident.
Third, and this one is a lot more specific, there is an MK tier writing inconsistency with Starfire. In-game, she is voiced by Kari Wahlgren and is written in the style of the animated movies in which she voices the character.
After I win, you want to get pizza?
In her ending, though, she is written in the very alien style of the Teen Titans cartoon version of the character.
The mustard with pizza on bottom.
This even extends to the Titans team depicted in her ending, coming from the cartoon, not the pre-established Injustice version, with Star's knowledge of their fates being just plain wrong. She knows Beast Boy died in Metropolis, Connor recovered his body, why does she think he's just missing? I would ask how the hell this happened, but, well, it's Netherrealm. I'll get more into this at a later time. But enough about audio and continuity. Let's talk visuals. The graphics are good. The colours are less muted than last time, though the aesthetic of the setting has only gotten worse. Most of the armors this time look like plastic and half the characters look fat in them. The faces in the final products were much improved over the first showing, but there's a definite uncanny valley element to it that was smoothed out by MK11. On the DLC front, Darkseid was the pre-order character like Goro was last time. I hate this day one DLC crap. If they're finished by launch, put the character in the base game and give pre-order codes for the first post-launch character instead. When you have a character who isn't in the story but is on the launch roster, that's a missed opportunity for a cool character that could show up in the plots like one of the many absentees whose absence goes unexplained. Post-launch, there were three character packs. Red Hood Starfire Sub-Zero, Black Manta Raiden Hellboy, Atom Enchantress Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. There are also a few post-launch premier skins like Black Lightning for Raiden and Vixen for Cheetah. Overall, a pretty good selection, though MK really should have only had one representative. I get that Sub-Zero was the logical choice after we had Scorpion last time, and that Raiden with a Black Lightning premier skin will sell better than vice versa, but come on, really? Guest fighters should not account for almost 50% of the DLC offerings, which it actually exceeds if you count each turtle separately. But, of course, those characters will do really well sales-wise, so greedy Netherrealm or Warner Bros. Is gonna go for it. But people buy a DC game for the DC characters, you know? And it kinda devalues the characters from the actual brand when you prioritize completely foreign characters over the many existing characters from the brand that deserve this slot much more than they do. fucking tone it down. And honestly, I think that's all there is to say about Injustice 2 outside of the story. So let's move on to that, I guess. The story this time around, rather than the stupid Civil War story from the last game, centres on a major threat the two factions have to unite to stop. There's a lot of potential here for self-reflection on the part of the characters, realising the good they can do as a team, and remembering what it was like in the old days. Let's see if they made proper use of that potential, or if I'm going to have to make a video on it. Naturally, the cutscenes are still pre-rendered. I get why they do this. It allows them to load up straight away, and they can be used to mask the low times of fights. This keeps up the pace of the story, foregoing unnecessary pauses and creating a more seamless experience. It also allows some scenes to be created that otherwise couldn't when something more taxing is about to happen. This also means that video compression will reduce the quality of the cutscenes, which has, admittedly, become less noticeable over the years. Imagine if the cutscenes were rendered in real time. The game could then allow the player to experience the story mode with their customized versions of the characters, similar to how Street Fighter V lets you use any costumes you want in its story mode. This would be particularly handy given that a lot of the default costumes are pretty wank, especially the characters who are, debatably, the four main characters of the story. Imagine how much better the story mode experience would be if it wasn't these horrendous looking costumes the characters wore, but rather, the ones the players themselves created. Anyway, the story opens with a flashback to the last days of Krypton. We follow Kara Zor-El, aka Supergirl, as she dodges Brainiac's death squads, which wipe the floor with Krypton's military. Kara heads to an observatory where she fully bears witness to the Mass Effect 3-esque devastation. Argo is seemingly destroyed and Kara is rescued by her mother. Allura sends her away on a ship to Earth, just as baby Kal-El is sent away. Krypton's explosion sends Kara off course. This is a really good sequence. I know that I'm risking costing NetherRealm precious right-wing sales by praising them again, but it's true. I've not seen many on-the-ground takes on Krypton's destruction, and this one is well shot, well animated, well performed, well scored. It's overall just a really good scene, which I'll come back to in a bit. But for now, just know that the game gets off on the right foot. The story then jumps forward to Bruce at a hearing about Superman's actions after the first game. The game is trying to paint Clark as a man who believes his actions are just, but, as I've discussed in the past, there really is no justifying anything he does after killing the Joker, even from the perspective of his morals being twisted. Bad scene. And no, I won't be using the nicknames I came up with last time for the regime characters. The writing this time is generally more true to the original characters, and let's be honest, calling Superman Space Hitler was a stupid, immature joke. I should have called him Ubermensch, that's a way smarter joke. We then go back once again, this time to several years ago, where Bruce and Damian are on their way to Arkham Asylum to stop Superman from killing the inmates. This is based on a story from year one of the comic, where a standoff between the two sides is interrupted by Harley initiating a prison break, which all results in Dick Grayson's accidental death. This scene does not feature Dick Grayson and only adapts the scene in the loosest way possible, but more on that later. In the Batwing, Damian is arguing for Superman's new approach while Bruce argues against it. Damian questions how Bruce would have reacted if it had been Gotham instead, and Bruce has no answer. I'll come back to this in a little bit. The Batwing is hacked and redirected away from Arkham. They eject, and Damian is shot down by Cyborg. I don't know how Victor justifies attempted homicide of a minor to himself, but he says that his friends were in Metropolis, listing Starfire and Beast Boy. In the comic, Beast Boy was indeed killed in Metropolis, but Starfire was at Titan's Tower with most of the other Titans, including Tim Drake, who continues to go unmentioned. I understand that Vic might not know Star was trapped in the Phantom Zone by Superman, but unless Superman lied and said she died in Metropolis too, I see no reason for him to think she did. Still, this is actual justification for Vic picking his side, which is more than we got last time, so bravo. This fight may be where you first realise that stage transitions are not available in story mode. It keeps things a bit more grounded and avoids having characters teleport back to where they started when the fight ends in a different location. It also makes each area of a stage feel like a unique stage, which is good since newer NetherRealm games tend to have woefully small stage selections, and at least the cutscenes actually take place in these stages, unlike MKX's random teleportations. Damian catches up and the two head for Arkham. They then take down a bunch of Arkham guards just doing their job, including this brutal, inefficient takedown of this poor guy. I'm not sure why Bruce can't just, like, walk in. It's not like these are Superman's militiamen. It's people who make sure the people Batman puts away stay put away. It's stupid. And you know what else is stupid?
So you won't kill, but you're fine with traumatic brain injuries. Secure the loading docks.
Okay, let's get into it. Remember before when Bruce had no answer to Damian's question about losing Gotham? And now the same. These are two very good questions that Batman, our lead character and moral pillar, has no answer to. Injustice is, theoretically, a story about a righteous man losing his way and coming into conflict with his allies that retain their original moral code. It should be a fascinating, morally complex story with both sides having good points to bring up for their ideology and against the other. But like with most superhero Civil War stories, Injustice is content to ignore the deeper morality and just throw the skill sets against each other to appease bloodthirsty fanboys. Damian asks two questions. One, what would be the outcome in a role reversal of the two ideological avatars, and the other, a major critique of the Batman character. And yet, despite raising these questions, the game doesn't have an answer to either. So why the fuck would you bring it up? It's fine, I guess, for Bruce to not have an answer to the first question. It's a tough hypothetical, and Bruce doesn't want to give any ground to Damian for fear of it enabling him to go down the dark path. I get it. Being a little more clear on that would be appreciated, but it's not vital. But for the other, there is no justification for this. It's fine to live in ignorance and pretend this hole in Batman's moral code does not exist, but if you bring attention to it, you have to do something with it. Not doing so is just shining a spotlight on this flaw of Batman's morals, and you do not want that when he is the good guy in a battle of morality. Diana opens the doors and kicks a gate in a threatening fashion. She doesn't try to talk him down as any real Wonder Woman would. She instead threatens him, talking about how Joker forced their hand, with her smug expression indicating that she's full of shit. At this point, I'd like to point out that this fight occurs before the power pills are created, so Batman shouldn't be able to just take down Diana, especially when he's tired from the previous fights and traversal across town. After using her own lasso to learn Clark's location, Bruce just leaves her lightly bound without even compelling her to not follow, so I don't know why she doesn't. Inside, Clark is intimidating the inmates, but Bruce arrives to stop him. The two finally have an actual debate about their ideals, again, something the first game didn't do. Their points are fairly stock, but the acting is good and I'm glad to see an actual debate for once. Though, I can't help but notice that Bruce's armor makes him look kinda fat. Or that Superman kinda looks like Bill Paxton. Bruce uses a red solar grenade to make it a fair fight, and beats Clark down in front of a bizarrely hanging cage that, outside of story mode, has a criminal inside it. I mean, even Joker's asylum from the first game wasn't this cartoonishly dehumanizing. As Bruce approaches with kryptonite rope, Damian enters with Victor Zsasz. Zsasz appeared in year 5 of the comics, serving as the catalyst for Damian to complete his transformation from Robin into Nightwing by murdering Alfred Pennyworth on Superman's orders. This set Damian on the warpath, executing Zsasz in his cell. Here, in year 1, Damian slits his throat to even Superman's horror. Now, there's no ambiguity here. Zsasz is dead. This completely contradicts what I just explained from the comic. Sure, you might say that the game is not beholden to the comic continuity, making one wonder what the fucking point of the comic is then, but they pull from the comic later to explain the presence of Green Arrow and Black Canary. I wish they'd make up their damn minds about the continuity between the two mediums. Because if the game and the comic aren't the same continuity and they are two separate entities, then I think that should be explicitly said so that the comic writers can actually have more freedom to tell a decent story instead of having to stick with the limitations of what the game does. The MKX comic had the exact same problem. There's basically no interaction, it seems, between the game writers and the comic writers, leading to all sorts of continuity issues. But then, that's Netherrealm writing in a nutshell, isn't it? Damian declares his allegiance to Superman and decries Batman's refusal to kill Joker as the reason Lois and Jason are dead, marking what I believe is the first time Jason Todd has been brought up in this canon. Superman may have mentioned him in the comic once, but you'd think the Robin that got murdered by the Joker would be something Superman's side would bring up a lot to convince Bruce of their righteousness. But as we've already discovered, the writing team is terrible at writing opposing viewpoints. Superman just gives up on killing the inmates and flies away with Damian. This marks the asylum scene as the entire extent of Damian's transition from Batman's sidekick to Superman's zealot, whereas the comic had it serve as the starting point where Bruce pushes Damian away after Dick's death and doesn't realise what he's done until it's too late to bring him back. The comic made it more gradual, while the game portrays it as all happening in a single night, which really ruins Damian's whole arc. Good job, guys. The story then moves 2 years after the first game, though it's never specific, which is odd when you consider how the franchise has always been very specific about its timeline. Bruce has been rebuilding Gotham and Metropolis according to Lucius Fox. We learn that Bruce has built Brother Eye, a satellite that goes bad in every continuity it appears in, without fail, to keep tabs on those who can't be prosecuted. Black Adam, Wonder Woman, Aquaman. After a nice heart-to-heart you'd normally see with Alfred and Bruce, Bruce leads Oliver and Dinah to the new Batcave in the Gotham Underground. He explains the purpose of Brother Eye, which is operated by Harley Quinn for some reason. Harley is all chummy with Ollie and Dinah, having been on good terms with Dinah and this Earth's Oliver in the comic. The game doesn't explain this, nor does it bother explaining that Oliver is from another Earth that Dinah was sent to by Dr. Fate after Superman almost killed her. Bios explain it, but the story mode does not, beyond Ollie referring to himself as the new guy. Those not familiar with the comic story must have been really confused by this. Harley explains that Gorilla Grodd has formed a group of villains called the Society and will be receiving a shipment of fear toxin from Scarecrow. So the trio head to the swamp for Chapter 2, The Girl Who Laughs. Yes, the chapters are still character focused, unfortunately, but they have actual titles now, which is nice. They spy on Scarecrow and Deadshot, only to be ambushed by Poison Ivy. Ivy apparently views Bruce focusing on rebuilding Gotham and Metropolis over preserving plant life as making him no better than Superman somehow, so she's with Grodd, infamous eco-terrorist that he is. It's not even like Bruce is expanding Gotham and Metropolis into plant-filled areas, and Ivy is taking issue with that, you know, something that would actually make sense. She's just pissy that he's focusing on putting some buildings back up in places where they already were, rather than focusing on the plants. This is idiotic. Harley cuts them free and tries to convince Ivy to team up again while Scarecrow engages Dinah in close quarters as if he stands a fucking chance. I'm not sure why Ivy is so cold towards Harley when the comic had already depicted them as being almost as close as they are in the New 52, even kissing at one point. I guess having characters on opposite sides who actually don't want to fight each other would be too complex a concept to include in this story about Batman punching Superman in the face. Harley comes across Oliver and Dinah collapsed from fear toxin, which isn't used to justify a fight with them, strangely enough. Instead, Scarecrow douses Harley with a new formula, which makes her hallucinate Scarecrow's monster form. The idea behind Scarecrow's design as being the result of fear toxin? Brilliant. Its execution in the story? Not so much. There's no personalization to it. Why would Harley find this form scary? Why wasn't he given gear themed around the Joker for use in this scene? After she beats him, he gasses her again, creating a stronger hallucination where she's now in a rundown carnival facing the Joker. He tries to convince her that she's still evil and she's switched into a costume based on her original animated series design, but it just doesn't look right. Maybe it's the more muted red or the lack of mask or just that the uneven split on the torso looks bad with these more realistic proportions, but it just looks off somehow. Fortunately, that whole
"Harley, you're losing control.
It's part of my charm"
crap from the trailer is not representative of the final product, as Harley has actually developed and she fights him off. That or she just can't take his edgelord emo design seriously. I know I fucking can't. Oliver blows up some of Scarecrow's boats, presumably killing at least 4 people. This causes Swamp Thing to appear to protect the swamp. He swipes the other 2 unconscious, so Harley takes him down because she's tough enough to do that, I guess. A firefight is broken out off screen by the time the fight ends, and Swamp Thing helps the heroes, but Scarecrow escapes. So yeah, 3 fights in 1 stage. I guess they wanted to get as much use from the swamp stage as possible since we never come back here, but the Joker stage is only used once and it does get worse next time. We then transition to Supergirl in space before rocketing to Kandark, where Black Adam and Wonder Woman chastise her for risking being discovered. Apparently, Adam found her ship, though we never learn where. Considering how big a deal they made of her in the marketing and prologue, you'd think we'd get a tiny bit more explanation than that. Even the comics don't bother. They discourage Kara from going out until they're ready to free Clark from his cell. Meanwhile, Bruce sends Harley's team to Gorilla City. Bruce offers to let Dinah and Ollie tag out because of their familial responsibilities, but Dinah wants to make up for not being here to stop Superman. Nice little scene, even if Bruce's plan to beat up Grodd and hope the rest will give up is fucking moronic. Thus, we enter Chapter 3, The Brave and the Bold, Green Arrow and Black Canary. Yes, to help mitigate the issue that less than half the cast gets to be playable, certain chapters give you 2 different characters to play as. We'll get to that in a minute. Grodd gives a speech to his forces, joined by Scarecrow, Deadshot, Bane, Cheetah, Ivy, Captain Cold and Catwoman. And no, it's never explained why they're working for Grodd, who wants gorillas to rule the world, but they are definitely not under mind control. Harley heads back to the jet while the other 2 head inside. It's revealed that Grodd has a silent partner, just as Ollie and Dinah enter. Dinah knocks Grodd, Selina and Bane down with one scream, which she will never be strong enough to do again. After some cute banter between the couple, Grodd leaves and the player chooses who fights Selina while the other fights Bane. This is kind of a replacement for past gimmicks, mini-games of Injustice and QTEs of MKX, and it's a genuinely good system that allows more characters to be played as without the need to pad out the campaign any further. One thing I do take issue with though is that once the fight is over, the other character is sent flying back towards their partner and the player then chooses which character will fight Bane while the other character sneaks around to cut his venom tubes. I think it would have been better, since almost every instance of this has the player choose a character when facing two opponents, for the character you don't choose to then be used automatically to fight the other character. For example, if you choose Dinah to fight Selina, then Oliver will automatically fight Bane, with Dinah coming in for the assist at the end. I think it would quicken the pace of the scenes and avoid invalidating everything the other character was doing off screen during the first fight. Also, you can often tell which character was intended to be chosen for the fight, as more effort was put into their exchanges with the enemy than the others.
Your spine will break like this.
Now you've done it. That was my favorite arrow.
Little birdie, you will sing a song of pain.
Oh, I'll sing a song, but you'll feel the pain.
Bane goes down and Dr. Fate appears to warn them about the greater threat. He offers to take them away by force if need be. If Dinah fights him, she makes a nod to the comic where Fate said fuck Fate when he saved her from her mortal wounds, but the game tones it down to
screw Fate,
which bugs me. Again, why is the game by the MK team shying away from mature elements that the comic embraces? The other character does nothing during this fight and Dinah takes the helmet off of Kent to give him back control. He leaves to consult the Lords of Order, a la Raiden in MK2011, but he's forbidden from saying what the threat is. I don't know why him putting the helmet right back on lets him maintain control now, but once he's gone, the two heroes catch up to Grodd, who has knocked out Harley. The other character keeps his minions busy during the fight, and there's a missed opportunity here. Imagine if, rather than fighting the heroes, Grodd uses a mental attack on the two, with the player choosing which character resists, having to then fight the other. I think between this game and MK11, there is only one time where the player's choice of character actually determines the opponent, and I think it's a cool concept worth exploring more. Once the fight is over, Brainiac's ship arrives.
Holy shit.
Shit is okay, but fuck isn't, I guess. Dinah and Ollie are teleported up to the ship and captured. Brainiac is after Superman to ensure the end of all traces of Krypton. As can be expected, Brainiac intends to capture a few cities and destroy the rest of the planet. We then cut to his forces attacking a city, and we're not going to see Ollie and Dinah again for a very long time. I certainly am glad those two came back from Earth 3. They provide so much value to the cause. Brother Eye is hacked by Brainiac, so Bruce armors up in his awful new plastic looking batsuit. Adam and Diana observe Brainiac's arrival, and Kara recognizes his ship. She tells him they need Cal now, so we cut to the prison where he's being held. Bruce enters to question him about Brainiac, gets little from him, and refuses to let him out to help. Clark sounds oddly sincere when asking Bruce to let him out to help. We then cut to a remote research station for Chapter 4, Invasion. Barry Allen is here as part of his reformation, having promised he wouldn't suit up. Reluctantly, he suits up anyway and heads to Metropolis, where civilians are being either disintegrated or rounded up. The drones are after something in particular, so why not either scan and dispose or round up and scan? Having both methods being used by efficient machines seems weird. Barry arrives to save some civilians, and we learn that Grodd is working for Brainiac. Barry is shot in the leg by Deadshot, allowing Cole to corner him and freeze his leg. Snart has a personal beef with the regime, who executed the other rogues, including his sister. After throwing Barry to player one side of the screen, they fight. I like this idea that there was an understanding the two once had, but that Barry siding with Superman led to Snart becoming a much darker person who doesn't even care about civilians anymore. Pretty good stuff. Back in Gorilla City, Selina is revealed as the Mole when she busts Harley out of captivity. Good, they let her be herself this time. Back in Metropolis, Barry encounters Deadshot, who claims Grodd put a bomb in his head like the Suicide Squad. It's not clear if this applies to just him, or if the other society members are in the same boat. A little more clarity would be nice, especially regarding Selina. Barry's then attacked by Reverse Flash. They have a running battle, which could have made for a decent minigame or QTE, ending in Gotham. Thorn apparently can't go back to his own time, as his present day ancestor was killed by the regime, making him a walking paradox. This raises a question once posed by a friend of mine. Since Barry is known to be capable of time travel based on his super move in this game, why doesn't he just go back in time to stop Joker from destroying Metropolis? Like, That's a very good question. And if we say the super move isn't canon and that Barry doesn't know he can do that, why can't Thorn? He is definitely capable of going through time and he only indicates that forward travel is closed off to him. I explored the idea when I wrote arcade endings for the Premier Skin characters. I get that it would invalidate the whole story if he did, so just saying that he can't time travel at all would help close this small hole in the story. Thorn runs away and Hal Jordan arrives, now restored to the status of Green Lantern. Barry doesn't trust him, so they fight. Upon realizing that Hal is seeking redemption like he is, the two agree to work together towards that end. See, this is what the first game was sorely lacking. Character growth, acknowledgement of who these people are supposed to be, interesting parallels between the characters. Don't let me down, game. You have the potential to be NetherRealm's best story. I know that's not saying much, but still. Bruce refuses to let Hal help because he didn't change sides until a couple hours after Barry did. A crate almost falls on them, but Hal catches it, so Bruce instantly changes his mind. Game. God damn it. In Chapter 5, Sea of Troubles, Bruce sends Hal to Atlantis to recruit Aquaman, who refuses to trust surface dwellers because he thinks Atlantis can stand against Brainiac. Hal struggles with his rage and defeats Arthur. As the city is invaded, the two work together.
That was fucking stupid.
Hal fights Cheetah, who thinks he's hiding Diana's location for some reason. Bane then enters, and Hal Shao Kahns him in rage. Arthur begins to trust Hal, but Atrocitus then arrives through a portal. He wants revenge for the Red Lanterns killed by the Sinestro Corps and tries to recruit Hal to the Reds, but Hal fights off his influence with the Oath. And then Atrocitus flees and is never heard from again. Yes, he's just gone from the plot after this, he's not part of Brainiac's forces, and his appearance really accomplishes nothing. Lovely. Brainiac sends ships down in this overly long and unfocused shot of the ships as if it's just now revealing Brainiac's main ship when we've already seen it before. Shorten the shot, center it a bit, maybe obscure Brainiac's ship more before this point, and this could work. We move to the detention facility for Chapter 6, Assault on Striker's Island, Blue Beetle, and Firestorm. They pass Damien and Victor's cells as set up for this chapter's fights. And this is it for Superman's followers that will be brought up in the story. We have no idea where Killer Frost or Hawkgirl are, the two who are voiced by Jennifer Hale, funnily enough. Anyway, none of the other characters seem to even care about those two. Supposedly there were plans to bring back characters from the first game as DLC, but I guess all that sweet guest fighter money was too tempting and the idea was scrapped. Sure would have been nice to know where they ended up that prevented them from helping save the Earth. The facility's alarms go off, so the heroes suit up. Adam and Diana enter the facility, supported by protesters demanding Superman's release. It's a weirdly underexplored idea, even in the comic, what the civilian populace thinks about Superman now. Did anyone support him throughout, maybe losing status as a result of his fall? Do people think he's being treated inhumanely in light of all the villains he stopped? Do they even know about the other Universe League? There's not a lot of time to explore these ideas, I know, but at least some hints via news broadcasts in the background or the comic would be nice. Jaime and Firestorm head to secure the generator as Kara frees Damien and Victor. Adam is stopping the generator, so the player fights him while the other fixes the generator. That done, Damien arrives in his Nightwing suit. Yes, despite being touted as Robin this time around, Damien is still Nightwing in the story. And you do fight him again later, which means that you fight him more when he's using his old moves than you do when he's using the new ones. Damien comes off as more of a whiny little bitch than Arkham Knight Jason Todd, which is saying something, and gets his ass kicked. Cyborg is trying to let Clark out of his cell as Kara arrives. Clark knows who she is, thanks to information about her being in his ship. The two have a nice chat showing the rare humanity in Clark before Kara leaves to back up Diana. Jaime is surprised at the notion of another Kryptonian, which the comic would later contradict by having him briefly meet Kara in between the games. Victor easily takes both heroes down, which will make the fight after next hilarious. One takes him down while the other keeps Superman's cell online. Kara and Diana arrive, so Firestorm creates Kryptonite, which Kara powers through somehow. Maybe it's artificial, so it doesn't work as well, I'm not really sure how Firestorm's powers work. The player fights Supergirl while the other fights Diana off-screen. They both win despite having gone down to Cyborg so easily. Firestorm tries to go nuclear to stop the regime, but Bruce arrives and tells him to stand down. Damien taunts Bruce about not knowing about Kara, which is the one thing he says to him all game after Chapter 1. Bruce then releases Clark from his cell, which kind of invalidates the entire chapter, doesn't it? Brainiac knows about Kara. That's all we learn in this scene, and it doesn't really amount to anything. The two groups sit around a table to discuss Brainiac's plans. Bruce takes Firestorm aside to chastise him and give him a secret mission. What this mission is, we never learn. Superman enters in awful new armor that he got from somewhere that makes him look like he's in his late 40s with a growing beer gut. Also, that awful headgear continues to look dreadful, especially when it bends as he talks. According to Kara, they have 48 hours to stop Brainiac. Cyborg is assigned to go with Selina and Harley to fix Brother Eye, so you can already guess which member of the team will be utterly useless in this chapter. They can't teleport because of Batman having messed with Victor's teleportation tech, so they have to walk there from Arkham. Everyone leaves aside from Clark and Bruce. Clark reveals the remains of the Justice League roundtable and asks why Bruce kept it, though he weirdly shrugs it off and says he'd forgotten it was there. Chapter 7, Breaking and Entering, sees the trio run into Poison Ivy, who uses pheromones to turn Harley against the others. Given the characters involved, this would have been way cooler if it was a Selina and Harley chapter instead, with the one the player chooses having to fight the other. While Harley's been dealt with, the other character fights Ivy. So, Ivy is mad at Selina for not being sent back to Arkham, thanks to Bruce? Okay. And then very coldly talks about how Harley is going into shock and will die. Again, the comic already showed that the two were very close, and no explanation is given for her being willing to let Harley die, but her petty beef with Selina is explained. Once the fight is over, Selina forces Victor to save Harley with a defibrillator. He even smiles when she's okay, suggesting there's hope for him yet, even if he does immediately say that Ollie and Dinah must be dead when Harley brings them up in the very next scene. They access the Batcave, but Selina has Harley stay outside to make sure no one gets in. Spoiler alert, they already have. Deadshot and Bane show up, and Bane says Grodd didn't believe Selina was working for Batman, which you'd think a psychic could have easily learned by scanning her mind. The player fights Bane while Deadshot's off-screen defeat is so pathetic we never even see his body. Brainiac sees Victor as the pinnacle of human evolution held back by his humanity and zaps him through the monitor to force Grid out of him. How exactly this works, I don't know. Surely it would have made far more sense for Brainiac to have hijacked an old set of cybernetics from Victor and given it life, rather than having a metal man just pull himself out of Victor. If this was a magical doppelganger, it would be fine, but this is all technology, so it really isn't. Fun fact, even with the Gold Edition, Grid can only be obtained by connecting to the mobile game, which means he will one day become unobtainable once the servers shut down. Then again, it's not like I thought NetherRealm cared about game preservation, since no MK game post 3 ever got a remaster. One of the two fights Grid, while the other gets the backup power online. Victor purges Brother Eye of Brainiac's influence, and Selina stops it from killing Victor by using Cyrax's serial number as a code. Fun not. We then apparently jump forward 47 hours because they have 1 hour left as Diana and Kara arrive in Metropolis where it's daytime while it's nighttime in Gotham. Yeah, I never really talked about this before now, but NetherRealm has this weird thing where time of day fluctuates based on stage, as they haven't made any alternate times of day for stages since 2011. While Superman was destroying Metropolis with Doomsday in the daytime, the Good League were fighting the regime in Gotham at night. Like, how hard is it to make a different time of day version of a stage? Especially when you have so few stages per game now that even this small addition would increase the stage count by about 25%. Chapter 8, Goddess of War, so named because Diana claims to have killed Ares in her pre-fight dialogue, sees Diana refusing to save people because she's not become any less of a bitch than she was before. And there are actually people out there who think this is in keeping with her canonical characterization as one of the most compassionate individuals in the DCU. Luckily, Kara is able to talk her into it. Talk Wonder Woman into saving civilians, and then Cheetah shoots them both with a purple space bazooka. Diana is attacked in a bar by Snart and Thorn. She reflects a freeze blast at Thorn and it looks so fucking stupid. It's a way of keeping him out of the action until Snart goes down, but he has super fast reflexes. He could easily grab her and put her in front of the blast before it ever reaches him. It turns out that Diana is the one who killed Lisa Snart, but Diana shows no remorse and blames Leonard for it. In gameplay, we see that the background extras are just sitting there drinking at the bar. Unlike the Arkham inmates, these guys can't simply be removed because the guy at the bar is a stage interactable. He's basically copied over from the monks in the background of MKX's Sky Temple. You can pick them up and throw them at the opponent, which makes sense in Mortal Kombat because it's morbidly hilarious that you can pick someone up and throw them at an enemy to make them explode. But how fucked up is it that Batman can pick up a civilian and throw them at a supervillain? Even with the darker tone of the story, or perhaps because of the darker tone of the story, this stuff really does not belong here. Maybe they should look to how different character types interact with certain objects differently, and have the hero simply remove the civilians from play to stop their opponent from weaponizing them instead, similar to how strong characters throwing large objects prevent agile opponents from using them to escape. Diana turns back to Thorn with a close-up that shows her shield floating behind her back. I know it's a common thing in games, but they could have at least tweaked its position in the cutscene to make it just a little less obvious. He breaks free and runs to player 2's side of the screen, claiming that Diana is dead in his time, which doesn't really mean anything since he's from the 25th century. Diana turns to leave, but Fear Toxin appears and then Superman does. Diana's next line delivery makes her sound like she's either deranged or doped up, neither of which I think are intentional.
We can beat them, Cal. Brainiac, Batman, they both go down today.
He accuses her of taking advantage of and manipulating him. She claims to have made him stronger and runs him through, knowing it's an illusion because Superman told her that she made him stronger. The problem is, I'm pretty sure Scarecrow has no control over the illusions. If this was Grodd messing with her head, it would be fine, but Scarecrow delusions draw exclusively on what's inside the victim's head, not from anything without. When Harley was doused, everything Joker said to her was something she felt about herself, worrying she'd slip up and go bad again. She has to gather up all her willpower to say no. But Diana is so resolute in her convictions that she doesn't worry at all that she has corrupted or manipulated Superman. You know, maybe I'm wrong about this, but I was always under the impression that Fear Toxin delusions are always based on some level of perceived truth or plausibility. Maybe this could have worked if the vision was of Superman murdering some Amazons that had come to help, so she thinks that maybe she has pushed Superman too far, and as a result her own people will suffer, you know, humanizing her a little bit instead of just leaving her as this horrible piece of shit. I don't know. I mean, before this baffling line, it comes off as if Diana does feel, at least subconsciously, that she has turned Superman into a monster. But that's not what's really going on. Scarecrow made it all up. Another opportunity for good character growth, wasted. Again, Crane becomes his monster form, which Diana shouldn't be afraid of, having faced far worse, so he should resemble a monstrous Superman or Wonder Woman or something. Or at least, say Scarecrow actually transforms and fully controls the nightmares, maybe as an augment from Brainiac or something he did to survive Joker's attempt to kill him in the comic. Then Diana hits his wrist with her sword and there's blood on the ground and I don't know what's actually happening here. We then cut to Kara, who has made her way to the elevated monorail platform from the street despite being barely able to stand. Did she just land there after getting shot by the bazooka? And Diana shows up to save her from Cheetah. We never see Scarecrow again, so maybe Diana killed him? Wouldn't fucking surprise me at this point. The two women circle each other and shift positions drastically between shots. I mean, look at this. After the fight, Diana goes to kill Minerva, but Harley just randomly shows up from Gotham and stops her. Harley puts Diana in her fucking place.
I was trying too hard to impress the wrong guy. Kinda like you with Superman.
So Diana stabs her. Kara cauterizes the wound and we seamlessly enter Chapter 9, Last Hope of Krypton. Kara calls Diana out for her lack of honor and takes her down. She then takes Harley away, saying Cal can protect her, which the delirious Harley laughs at. Kara arrives at the fortress where Cal is absorbing sunlight. Adam claims the Rock of Eternity prevents Brainiac from finding Kandark, which will be important later. Damien apparently told Cal about the scene with Harley and Diana, which he somehow knew about, but they don't seem to know that she drop-kicked Diana off the stage. Cal comments on how Harley should have been killed sooner, and Kara realizes he killed the Joker and so many others. Horrified by what the House of El symbol now represents, Kara compares Cal to Zod and flees. He orders Adam and Damien to stop her, and Damien can actually go toe-to-toe with her even without any pills. Again, this game just doesn't bother to explain why the characters are able to fight each other, even though Injustice 1 and MK vs DCU went to great lengths to explain it. They really dropped the ball with this here. Adam is one of the most true-to-form characters in the story, citing Shades of Grey as the truth of the world. But then he can't take down a Kryptonian even with his magic, which is one of the few canonical weaknesses of Kryptonians, which was something even MK vs. DCU acknowledged.
Magic.
Kara tries to get through to Cal, but it does no good and they fight. Brainiac apparently begins extracting the cities early, which I really have to question. Remember, they had an hour left when the previous chapter was starting. In that time, there have been 8 fights, and Kara has flown from Metropolis to the Fortress of Solitude. That must have taken over an hour altogether. So they had 47 hours pass between the start and end of one chapter, and then the next 2 chapters all take place within a single hour? What the hell is up with this time frame? Why couldn't they just say that all 3 chapters took place over the course of about one day, and that Brainiac began extracting the cities a day early? And I'm not really sure what the story actually gains from this weird claim that Brainiac's extracting the cities early, when even if this happened at the start of the previous chapter, it would only be 1 hour early, so who gives a shit? Sometimes I wonder if the scripts for NetherRealm story modes actually go through more than one draft, and it's shit like this that makes me wonder that. Anyway, Cal says that Kara has to choose if she is with him or against him once this is all over, sounding ever more like Anakin fucking Skywalker. So yeah, Kara accomplishes nothing in this chapter. At all. Third cover character, and she's fucking worthless. You can be damn sure that's going to be a major talking point later on. Brainiac begins the extraction as Dr. Fate stands among the corpses and the rubble. It's nothing special, but it does a better job of depicting the devastation than when the regime attacked Metropolis and Gotham last time, where the streets were always devoid of anyone outside of the playable characters and their stormtroopers. Naboo tells Kent that he can't interfere, as Brainiac is order. I guess this is about as close as we can get to exploring the concepts of MK's Order Realm without fanboys spitting their dummies out. Bruce and Selina attack Brainiac's ship in the Batwing while the others engage the fleet off-screen. They are joined by Clark and Kara, and we miss another chance for a potentially fun minigame. Brainiac's shield basically hits back as hard as it is hit, which almost gets Bruce and Selina killed, but Superman saves them. Kara hits it, and both she and Clark get electrocuted instead of just being knocked back by a concussive blast, as happened to the Batwing, and are sent crashing back to Earth. That done, Brainiac wraps up the extraction. After making sure Kara is okay, Clark returns to the sky and is horrified by the devastation, despite having tried to destroy the city and all of its inhabitants himself last time. Really tempted to go back to calling him Space Hitler. Bruce tells him to hit the shield quickly from multiple angles because it focuses on the spot where it struck, but Brainiac counters this and takes Clark down again. He lands in the middle of the Metropolis crater, making me think of Man of Steel and highlighting how boring the destruction of Metropolis is by this point. Brainiac lasers Clark into seeming oblivion. The heroes begin to converge on the spot, with Kara saying she can't find the body and being surprised to learn that Bruce is also saddened by the news.
I'll miss him too.
You mean that?
He was a good friend once. I trusted him with my life. But the Joker got to him, and I wasn't there to stop it. I lost my friend Clark, and I've missed him ever since.
I really do have to wonder if this game had a different writing team from the first game, or from MK11 especially, because some of this stuff is really good. You know, if you ignore the generic, repetitive music playing throughout the scene.
I couldn't find his body. Can't hear his heartbeat. I was supposed to protect him.
I think silence would be more effective here. Hal, Victor, and Arthur arrive as Atlantis is gone, so Arthur is finally ready to join the fight. Diana somehow blames Bruce for all of this and refuses to work with him anymore because fuck what I just said about the game having good writing, I guess. Brainiac extends an offer to spare the Earth if the heroes hand Kara over. Bruce, naturally, refuses. The new plan is to have Adam use the Rock of Eternity's power to take down Brainiac's shields, channeled through Aquaman's trident, and then have Brother Eye disrupt Brainiac's signals to take down the beta ships. It's nice when characters other than Batman and Superman get to do things. So begins Chapter 10, Three Kings. Adam opens the door to the pocket dimension where the rock is hidden, attracting Brainiac's attention. The society disbanded once they realised Brainiac planned to destroy the Earth. And yet they don't join the heroes to help stop him. Idiots. Grodd remains loyal, so Brainiac has Grodd send his forces to retrieve some of the rock with his new minions. Said minions are the mind-controlled Oliver and Dinah with 5 guerrilla soldiers. Yeah, because they stand a chance against the two kings. The first opponent is Dinah, while the other character deals with the gorillas. I like that, while the eye fluctuating, head twitching, and Grodd influence don't carry over to gameplay, the vocal effect at least does.
You fight like a man.
Don't insult me.
Oliver is next. Grodd claims he only cared about himself and plans to overthrow Brainiac. The other character deals with a beta ship and Blue Beetle arrives to help. The three enter the pocket dimension where Beetle turns out to be under the control of Grodd, who walks in from the opposite direction of the entrance as if he got in before they did. This form of control is completely different from Ollie and Dino, where it was direct control with the external influence being very clear, while this is Jaime being able to act naturally and receive verbal commands. If he can do the subtle approach, why not have Oliver and Dinah be sleeper agents as well, then have all three ambush the two alongside Grodd and the gorillas? It would make a lot more sense. Once Jaime goes down, Grodd is defeated, and Aquaman straight up shanks him with the trident, killing him. Well, I guess he's not coming back for Injustice 3, unless one of the cast is really scared of him. Dinah and Ollie wake up and banter before Arthur runs past, apparently not surprised to see the dead man and mortally wounded woman despite seemingly having not been told they were back. He channels the power of Adam, who exclaims, which I can't find any evidence to support being a thing he says. I don't know, with all the other stuff that's different in this universe, maybe this version of Black Adam gets his power from Shaquille O'Neal. Cyborg arrives with the disruptor and gives it to Batman with no snide comments or anything. It's like he's actually Cyborg again. The lightning strikes Brainiac's ship, giving Bruce and Kara their opening. From here, most of the heroes don't show up again as they deal with the betas off screen. I wish we could get some of them doing more in the climax, like if Brainiac and Grodd were controlling the other society members, so the heroes had to fight them so we could get a few extra fights in, but I guess we should just be thankful they were written mostly in character in the time we did get with them. The Batwing crashes inside and Bruce and Kara proceed on foot. They find the captured cities, including Kandor and Argo, but are immediately captured by tentacles. Kara is taken into a wall, ending her involvement in the plot until after Brainiac's defeat. Again, third cover character, hyped up in the pre-release material, and she's fucking worthless. Brainiac says Batman isn't special and isn't worth preserving, despite earlier having an interest in his tech, so you'd think he'd at least want to probe around inside his head a bit first to acquire it, unless he stole the info he needed from Brother Eye and we're just not told. He has to verbally command his drones to kill Batman and then leaves because he's a genius, you see. Clark arrives to save Bruce and shows genuine concern for Kara. And no, they never do explain how he survived seeming obliteration, nor where he was for the subsequent chapter. And so the two set off together for Chapter 11, World's Finest, Batman and Superman, which I think is a metaphor for what DC thinks will happen if the two are ever portrayed as friends again. They're quickly confronted by Firestorm and Swamp Thing, both of whom are under Brainiac's control. I would think that controlling Swamp Thing would be like controlling a god, i.e. straight up impossible, but he somehow can. The player chooses who fights Firestorm first, while Swamp Thing goes down to the other character and then gets up again. Once he suffers a real defeat while the other character fights drones, Bruce uses the disruptor to snap them out of it. Oh, and those orbs in the background, I'm pretty sure those are the captured cities or planets. Yeah, you can just throw them at people and destroy them. Good job, heroes. Firestorm is told to take Swamp Thing back to Earth and join Hal, rather than doing the logical thing and helping to fight Brainiac. Of course. Then Dr. Fate arrives to kill the two to end their chaotic conflict. Even though they're working together to prevent the destruction of the Earth, which falls in line with the concept of order, right? The player fights him while the other character tracks Brainiac down. Superman crushes the helmet, freeing Kent from its hold, just in time for Brainiac to impale him and kill him. No blood, weirdly. Some scenes do have it, but the moments that most need it just don't. What? Brainiac arrives talking about the environment and resources as if the writers want us to think the game has a message. Bruce is knocked out, so Clark fights Brainiac, who claims Kara is being vivisected. Just try not to get hit with his super move or he'll attack you with a laser from his ship while you're inside his ship. You know, considering he's the boss in both story and multiverse, the ship interior is where you're going to see this move the most, so it may have been wise to change it. Bruce uses the disruptor on Brainiac to cut him off from his fleet and even his ship. This saves Kara, whose grunts sound nothing at all like Laura Bailey. It also means there's no one to control the ship, so Clark hooks himself up to it to stop it from crashing and destroying the captured cities.
This could kill you. Sounds like a job for me.
And with that, Superman is fucking back. He stops the ship from crashing just as Brainiac gets back up. Kara weakens him with heat vision and Bruce steps in to fight him next. Because God forbid Kara do anything or that anyone other than Batman deliver the final blow. Yes, Batman's fight is the one that puts Brainiac down for good. Really should have been Kara. Bruce tells Clark to get out of the chair, but he refuses, choosing to restore the captured Earth cities first, showing that the heroic spirit does still burn within him. Diana, Hal, Barry, Arthur and Adam then show up out of nowhere. Apparently some cities are still trapped or were erased by Brainiac entirely, including both Metropolis and Coast City, because the one other city we needed to see destroyed again was Coast City. Hal's family and Carol Ferris are presumably all dead then, but Hal barely seems to care beyond Clark apologising about it. Diana compares this to Krypton and says no other world should suffer this, setting Clark off to kill Brainiac, which Bruce tries to stop. Bruce argues they need him alive to restore the cities, but Clark now believes he can do it given time. And so, the arguing starts again, without even any changes in alignments like Hal going back to Clark's side after losing his hometown or one of the regime members having a change of heart. Bruce cuts Clark with gold kryptonite to weaken him because the only character who ever gets an actual reason to lose a fight in this game is Clark. Diana, Kara, Adam, they can just lose to any fucker on the street, but not Clark. And this brings us into the final chapter, where the player has to pick a side, making Clark playable in 2 chapters and Bruce playable in 3. Fuck off. The two versions play out the same until the final battle, so I'll discuss both at once. Hal and Barry try to defuse the situation while the regime members attack. Hal throws Clark out of the ship and gives chase, leaving Bruce to fight Arthur, who is motivated by Atlantean justice, I guess. Clark and Hal, meanwhile, crash into Gotham outside that same theatre where every other fight in Gotham takes place. Clark tries to convince Hal to join him, but he resists the rage and fights. Bruce incapacitates Arthur with the trident and then saves Kara from Adam while Barry takes down Diana in a cutscene. Bruce fights Adam in Gotham at the same time Clark is breaking Hal's hand in that same location. What is this, Resident Evil 2? Kara and Barry arrive to stop him, but he just chokes Kara, showing that there's no heroism left inside him. He launches her through a building, then punches Barry down the street, causing him to crash into the theatre behind them, which isn't even the worst instance of spatial inaccuracy we're going to see this chapter. Clark accuses Barry of causing the regime to fall and leaving Earth vulnerable to Brainiac, and then Kara comes back to urge him to stop. He talks about holding back, which I think is them attempting their version of the World of Cardboard speech from Justice League Unlimited. If it is, it really doesn't work because this is just Clark trying to justify the regime's existence because him holding back apparently cost him Lois to one of Batman's enemies. Do you see the logical fallacy here? Kara flies off and Clark gives chase, joined soon after by Diana. Bruce has Kara lead Clark and Diana to the Batcave where he awaits with a new batsuit with glowy green trims that I guess are supposed to be kryptonite, but it's not said explicitly. There are 2 problems with this part. 1. The scene cuts, in the Superman version, from the 3 flying underground to them running into the scene, and the much slower pace of the movement and the unexplained change in their travel method is unintentionally hilarious. It looks like 2 completely separate scenes have been stapled together, and it doesn't look natural at all. 2. Kara leads them in from the direction of the back computer, despite the door being on the opposite side of the chamber. This is so that Bruce can arrive behind them to fight Diana from the left side, while Kara is on the right side, meaning Clark is also on the left side because it always has to be that way. Seriously, once you notice that every scene is choreographed in such a way that the character you're playing as will be on the left side of the arena, it's impossible to unsee and it feels like a massive contrivance every time it happens. Bruce calls out Diana for making Clark worse and then hits her a bunch, which is very satisfying. In the Batman version, Clark and Kara fly off for their fight. In the Superman version, they don't, and Bruce and Diana aren't seen leaving either. Instead, they just disappear from the scene when the angles used often show the area where they should be standing. Belligerent cunt that he is, Clark refuses to hear Kara's pleas and instead says that if Jor-El was like Zod, Krypton could have been saved. Funny that we never learned where Zod was during the attack. Might have lent some credence to Clark's claims, but that would have made too much sense, so no. Regardless of version, Kara is unconscious on the upper level and Diana is nowhere to be seen as Bruce approaches. Clark does apologise to Kara, but it comes off as wildly inconsistent writing rather than a man being pushed to hurt his loved ones for what he believes is right, but knowing that hurting them is wrong.
Fighting on the same side, it felt like old times. But I guess we both knew it would end this way.
I did.
I miss the people we were then.
Me too.
Fuck Fucking hell. That has to be intentionally funny, right? They couldn't possibly have had such an abrupt punch without realizing how funny it was. Bruce flies back towards the computer and ends up crashing through the wall into the lower area, going that way in gameplay leads to the sewer where Croc sends you down. He could have smashed him down through the floor, given that Clark then follows him downwards. The sense of space in this scene is all over the place. But hey, at least Bruce turns around to face Clark in the Superman version so that the player is on the left side no matter what. Because that's more important than spatial consistency, am I right? In absolute justice, Bruce knocks Clark out and apologizes to Kara for not being able to save him. We then see Bruce sending Clark into the Phantom Zone where Doomsday probably still is. Bruce then offers Kara a place on the new team. In absolute power, Clark actually refuses to kill Bruce to stop him from becoming a martyr.
Why did you say that name?
Diana is not happy about this and demands he do something about Kara because Diana is still the biggest piece of shit in any of NetherRealm's games and one of the biggest in all of media. That is not hyperbole, I fucking mean it. Clark upgrades himself with Brainiac tech after killing him and plans to build an army from the trapped civilizations. He tries to convince Kara to join him, threatening to brainwash her like he did to Batman. And for some reason, this is the ending they used as the basis for the He-Man crossover comic last year. Unlikely as it is, I genuinely worry that this is the one they'll use in the next game too, because NetherRealm is just edgy enough to do something like that. It was all going so well. Despite a few hiccups, the characters were starting to come back around to being themselves. Hal, Victor, Arthur, and even Clark towards the end. But God forbid we get any kind of progress in the plot that a single one of the fallen heroes realizes how far they've fallen this time. The ending betrays any goodwill the story had earned up to that point by having the regime throw away their development and redemption for a contrived climax and you either end the game back where we started or with a scenario that is so absurd and depressing that the chances of it actually being canon are incredibly low. There was definitely an injection of Kerr put into the writing as, unlike the first game, even with the terrible direction the story goes, the dialogue was written with the proper character relationships in mind for the most part. We do have the issue of characters dropping off the face of the Earth partway through, Damian isn't seen after the scene in the fortress, the society members disappear after losing to either Diana or Vic and Selina, Grid and Atrocitus disappear after one fight each, as does the imaginary Joker, those that Grodd mind control don't appear again after the shield goes down, Victor disappears after giving Bruce the Disruptor, Selina is gone after Brainiac takes Metropolis, and only Harley has a good enough reason to go due to being hospitalized. Also Grodd, because he kinda dies. The writing was better, I'd say, but the story feels pointless. The first game at least felt like something was accomplished. This time either nothing changes or we effectively undo all the work of the Prime League from last time. I've got some ideas for how to make this story more palatable, which will be explored in the Wasted Potential episode. In conclusion, Injustice 2 is a step up in terms of graphical fidelity, obviously, and the gameplay feels smoother than previous NetherRealm games, even if the animations are still a bit naff. I even somewhat enjoyed playing the video game this time, which has to count for something. It's seriously lacking in content though, which does reduce the game's shelf life sadly. MK11 fixed that though, so Injustice 3 should be back up to par in that regard. Maybe we can get a crypt style mode run by Larfleeze. The story is easily the best one NetherRealm has ever done. It's let down by the ending, but I at least felt that the writers had a good grasp on who these characters are, except for Wonder Woman. The same definitely cannot be said for any other NetherRealm story. Honestly, it gave me hope for future stories until MK11 happened. I don't know what happened in the intervening 2 years that led them from their best to their worst, but something definitely went horribly, horribly wrong. At the very least, Injustice 3 might have a shot at being a satisfying conclusion to the trilogy, assuming the chuckle fucks behind MK11's garbo fuck ending get locked in the Phantom Zone for the duration of development. If you liked this video, why not subscribe and support me on Patreon like these fine people here? If not, then make sure to share it with your enemies so they can suffer along with you. Today's recommended playlist is NetherRealm Sucks at Animation by ABI from Sugar Punch. Animation isn't my specialty, so I can't properly convey the issues with this, but I think this critique wouldn't feel complete without it. So consider these videos the season pass DLC you need to make this bare bones NetherRealm experience feel like a complete package. Damn, I'm good at this!